right. Alrighty. How's everyone? All right? Good? Good? Good. It is a joy to be in a church that has such tremendous talent and willingness to serve, and I'm blessed to be a part of your family, and I appreciate that. And now you've given me the opportunity, and so has the Lord, to bring what I can to him and to you, and that is to jump into his word. The scriptures tell us that the pastor's job is to equip God's people to do God's work. And that's the best way for me to do that is to give you God's word, as he uses to prepare his people to do every good work. And so that's what I intend to do. We started a series a couple weeks ago called The God of the Mountain, The God of the Valley. And the subtitle to it was that we're going to try to experience God's presence everywhere. It's a perspective change, really. That's what this is really all about. It's a perspective change. And we all need a perspective change. The story that jumped out of the scriptures that captured me, that inspired me to go deeper into his word and bring this series to you, was a story in 1 Kings chapter 20. I don't know if you've had the chance to read it, but it's a story of Israel, and they are going to war, go figure, against this country, Aram. And so the enemy comes, and they fight, and they lose. Israel wins. And so what they do is they say, well, listen, let's gather up some more troops, and let's give this another whirl, because the gods of the Israelites, polytheistic people they were, and they thought that we had gods. We only have, how many gods do we have? Show me with a finger. The correct finger. Okay. One god. But they said the gods of the Israelites are the gods of the mountain, but they're not the gods of the valley. So obviously the battle had been fought up on top of a mountain somewhere, and they lost. And so they said, let's give it another whirl in the valley, because we can whoop them there. And so the Lord answers and says, I'm not going to tell the opponent that I'm the Lord of the mountain or of the valley. I'm going to have you win so decisively that you will all know that I am Lord. Period. I'm God. And so they whip up on him once again. And we wanted to study the mountains and the valleys, sometimes up on a real mountain, Sinai and stuff, and then sometimes proverbial mountain will go down into a proverbial valley, and so on and so forth. We've done that for a couple weeks. And this week, I offered you on Facebook, and I certainly hope that you'll utilize our page, because it is actually useful on occasion. I know there's some Facebook haters here, but Facebook can be helpful on occasion. What I shared with you on Facebook this week was this. Who's ever gone into a movie and the movie's already started? Anyone? Kind of ruins the movie, right? Can kind of have an adverse effect on the movie if you don't catch it, right? You kind of jump in the middle and kind of mess you up, right? Well, I had that same feeling this week, because I can't read you the entire story of Joseph. It's just too long. And so what I encourage you on Facebook was to go ahead and read Genesis 37 through 50 before you got here this week. For those of you who did it, you are blessed, and you will receive much from tonight's talk. But for those that did not, let's just pray that the Holy Spirit will work anyway, and I believe that he will. I want to share with you the story of Joseph, because in Joseph's life, like no one else, you will see him on a mountaintop, and you will see him in a valley. One man, several different situations. So I'm going to just skim through and tell you his little story here, and then we'll dive into his word in detail. Chapter 37, you'll see what happens. Joseph is a young man. He is the nation of Israel starts with Abraham, then Isaac, then Jacob. You know what I'm talking about? You know those names? And after Jacob comes Joseph. Joseph was born to Jacob when he was wicked. I'm from Boston. You ready? When he was wicked old. So he was his favorite. He was his favorite. He found favor with his father so much he got that. Anyone here with a multicolored jacket, that robe that Joseph got? You church folks, you know what I'm talking about. If you don't, it was just a special gift that his dad gave him, kind of like Nick's shirt over here. See the stand up and model Joseph's jacket. Look at that. See that? Not sure it had a kitty on it, but it probably looked similar to that. But he was daddy's favorite, and the other kids didn't like him because of it, right? They don't like favorites, and so they were mad at him. They didn't like him very much. But he had some dreams. In chapter 37, he had some dreams. And these dreams, I'm not going to tell you about them, but the dreams kind of said that, brothers, all of you, and mom and dad, you're all going to bow down to me. Well, they didn't say that. They never said amen. They didn't like that. Like, who are you to tell me I'm going to, like, you got kids? Yeah. What would you do if your kids told you that? One day, mom, you're going to bow down to me. Whack, right? Don't you ever. Yeah, well, he had that dream, and he had two of those dreams, and it ticked everybody off so bad, so the brothers, they wanted to kill him. They hated him, and so they were going to kill him, but then they said, I don't want to live with, see, they're Jewish, and we have guilt like crazy. We just live on guilt. It fuels our fire. They didn't want that guilt, so they didn't want to kill him, so what they were going to do is they're going to throw him what they said in the Bible was a cistern. Now, I don't know really what that cistern looked like. Anyone was there? No. No, I wasn't there. Tim said he was there. I think, I don't know if it was a big jar up here, or maybe it was some kind of like a well or something like that. Well, it doesn't really say, it says cistern, like a container. So it says, well, instead of like living with that guilt, let's just chuck him in the cistern and he'll just kind of die on his own. I don't want to have blood on my hands. So they're going to chuck him in the cistern. That's not much better, but they felt bad. So then they decided, well, we'll chuck him in there. So they chuck him in there, and then all of a sudden some slave traders come. They're like, oh, no. So if we're going to like waste this dude, let's make some cash. That's horrible. So they sold the kid to a slave trader for 20 pieces of silver. And I don't know what that amounts to in today's economy or even back then, but I would just say kind of what? Not much, right? Not much. Very low value of human life. So they sell him to the slave traders. And in chapter 39 now, he's brought to Egypt and sold to this guy Potiphar, who was the captain of Pharaoh's personal guards of his palace. Pharaoh was the king of Egypt, if you didn't know. And so he sold to this guy as a slave to his master. So let me ask you a question. At this point in his life, with everything that just happened, mountain or is he in a valley? He's in a valley. So here's Joseph in a valley. Chapter 39, verse 2, but he's in the valley. But the Lord, it says the Lord was with Joseph in the valley. Now, look here in chapter 39, look in verse Well, let me just read you some here. At the beginning of the chapter, it says, when Joseph was taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelite traders, he was purchased by Potiphar. And in verse 2, the Lord was with Joseph. What's that mean? He's hanging out next to him? So he succeeded in everything he did as he served in the home of his Egyptian master. Like, he didn't have a really good job, did he? He was a slave. How many people don't like their job? Liars. You all lie. Right now, I don't like mine if you're going to lie to me. Potiphar noticed this and realized that the Lord was with Joseph, giving him success in everything he did. This pleased Potiphar, so he soon made Joseph his personal attendant, his own personal slave. So still not awesome, but better. He put him in charge of his entire household and everything he owned. From the day Joseph was put in charge of his master's household and property, the Lord began to bless Potiphar's household for Joseph's sake. Joseph, say amen. Come on. maybe your house is blessed because you're there. All his household affairs ran smoothly, and his crops and livestock flourished, right? So Potiphar gave Joseph complete administrative responsibility over everything he owned. With Joseph there, he didn't worry about a thing except, yeah, what should we have for dinner? That was his only care. Well, what should we have for dinner? That was it. So what would you say here? Is he on a mountain or on a valley now? Huh? Mountain, right? I can see clearly now, the rains are gone. Yeah, that is a good song. So he's gone from the valley, now but the Lord was with Joseph, and now everything's going well. He's up on top of the mountain, but like instantly, very next verse, I won't read it, but what happens is Joseph apparently is like really good looking. Must be the name, hey, Joe? Yeah. And so Potiphar's wife, she she likes him. And she's digging Joseph big time. And so she likes, you know, hey baby, you know, let's go hang out. And so he gets into the room, and she like corners him and says, all right, you know, this kid's in the room. I'm trying to be nice. I'm trying to be good. So you guys know what I'm talking about here? Yeah. You know what is the desire of her wretched heart, right? So she corners him and says, and let's do that thing. And he's like, no. So he runs off, and so she accuses him of rape. Rape. Try to rape me. So verse 20, he's thrown in jail. So he's in the valley. He went to the mountain, and now what? Where's he at, mountain or valley? Yeah, he's back in the valley. But look, but, verse 21, but the Lord was with Joseph again in the prison and showed Joseph his unfailing love. So we see, if you read on here, that in the jail he found favor with the warden and he put Joseph in charge of all the other prisoners and over everything that happened in the prison. The warden had no more worries because Joseph took care of everything. It goes on to say again, the Lord was with him and caused everything he did to succeed. Mountain or valley? Huh? Valley, no! Mountain. It doesn't, you get in the, you guys not picking up on this? It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter your circumstance. If the Lord is with you and he's showing his love to you, you're on the mountain. Even if you're in jail. I won't ask who's been there. Yeah, amen. So he's in jail, right? And while he's in jail, two of the Pharaoh, the king's servants, the cupbearer, I'm from Boston, so the cupbearer, the guy with the cup, and the baker, they're in jail and they have dreams too, and Joseph interprets their dreams, and the dreams lead to reality, and one of them is impaled on a pole because Joseph said, yeah, that's what's going to happen, and he does, and the other one gets released and gets back to his job, which is exactly what happens. So when they get out, then the Pharaoh has a dream, and he's like, man, who's going to figure out this dream? And no one knows, and finally one day the guy with the cup, he fesses up and says, oh man, there was this dude in the big house when I was there, and he can interpret dreams. So the Pharaoh's like, go get that guy and help me, I need to know. So he interprets the dream. He interprets it rightly. And look, in verse 38 of chapter 41, he doesn't say that the Lord was with Joseph, but look what it says. Chapter 41, verse 38, it says, the Pharaoh, the guy who doesn't even believe in our God, says, it's so noticeable. Listen, before I read it, you know the scriptures say that if anyone's in Christ, the old person has died. Behold, I can see a new person, right? Look at this. The non-believer guy says, can we find anyone else like this man so obviously filled with the Spirit of God? It was so noticeable that the Lord was with this guy that even the person who didn't believe in God could see it. The Lord was with Joseph big time. And so Joseph is now, this is crazy, now he's put in charge, other than the king of Egypt, the second person in charge of the entire country is Joseph the Jew. That's crazy favor. Crazy favor. Now the dream says there's going to be a famine. And Joseph's put in charge of all the food that's brought in for the years before the famine, so he can distribute it. They become the most powerful nation in the world because they're the only ones with food. Now everyone's going to come to them. And who do they come to get food? Pharaoh, right? And who's Pharaoh's guy? Joseph. They come to Joseph. He becomes like the most powerful person in the world. Is he on a mountain or is he in a valley? He's on a mountain. The famine breaks out. His brothers, who hated him and wanted to kill him, they are forced to come to Egypt and buy food from him.
But they don't know who he is, and he doesn't tell them who he is, and they go through this whole process. Please read it. It's really a neat story. But in chapter 45, he finally reveals his identity to his brothers. And then in chapter 50, verse 20, kind of a summary of the whole story of Joseph, where it just says, he looks at his brother after just saying, hey, this is who I am. He goes, what you intended for evil and harm, God intended it all for good. This whole story of up and down, peaks and valleys, mountain and valley, all of it was intended by God for good. And I want to take some time to examine this whole idea of God, the Lord is with me. That's the whole premise behind this series, was talking about the Lord is with you. If you have said yes to his free gift of eternal life, if you said yes to his son Jesus, the Lord, listen everyone, look at me, the Lord is with you. He's with you right now. But it needs to mean something, because like I'm here with you right now. But that's different than this. Just being here, no one, who wants lip service? Anyone like lip service, right? Actions speak louder than words. The Lord is with me carries meaning. The Lord is with me. It's all throughout the scripture, this whole idea of that the Lord is with you. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you, right? Jesus said, go make disciples and I'm with you to the end of the age. He's always with us, always with us. In the Old Testament, there was two words, and I probably can't even pronounce them properly. I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but the Old Testament, this whole idea of will never leave you is Azab. Azab means I will never loosen my grip. I will never relinquish my hold. I will never fail you. I will never leave you. I will never leave you destitute, unable to take care of yourself. I'm there for you. So I'm not just present, but I'm going to actively do things on your behalf while I'm there. Also, the word Rapha, which is one of God's names, Jehovah Rapha, but that's the whole idea of the Lord is with me. What does it mean that I'm with? What do you mean, Lord, that you're with me? What does that mean that you're with me? It sounds good, but no one wants a bunch of Christian platitudes getting thrown at you. What's the meaning of this, Lord? Well, it means I will never slacken. I will never cease. I will never fail you. I will never leave you. I'll never let you be alone. I will never be slothful in my work for you. I'll never be weak in providing and defending you. I will constantly mend you. I will constantly repair you. I am with you. I am on the job and I am present at all times. That's who God is. That's who God is. In the New Testament, you see that same verbiage in Hebrews 13:5 about not leaving or forsaking you. I will not desert you. I will not leave you. And it's not that I won't just be there, like in word, but in deed. You know, the faith without works is what? Dead. Like, so when God says, I love you, it's a showing of the love. It's when I say I'm with you, that means you're going to notice that I'm here. I'm not just going to be like annoying Nat. I'm going to be here helping you on your behalf. Never sit in the front. That's just what happens. Okay? That's who this God is. It means that there's going to be proof with you, means that there's proof of this thing. He showed, it says that the Lord was with Joseph and he showed him this unfailing love. It wasn't just saying that I'm there, but I'm going to prove to you that I am here. How? Well, if you read the story of Joseph, you see it right from the beginning. It was God's favor and blessing. He had favor with his father. He had favor with Potiphar. He had favor with the jailer. He had favor with Pharaoh. All the time, this guy had favor and blessing no matter where he was, no matter what his circumstances were. He was always blessed. Because God was always there showing, that's a big word, showing his unfailing love. This word showing, I lost my train of thought. This word for shown in the Greek is agapeo, not agape, it's agapeo. See, the agape love is this lavishing out of, it's almost like, the best illustration I can give you is like we talked about here months ago, it was a love feast. It's this constant outflow of just adoration and love, kind of like a daddy would do to his little princess, just gifting and love, endless stuff, just a lavishing of gifts, just out of love. God is a lot of different types of love. And this one here is agape O. It's not the same as agape A. This one carries the meaning of a moral or social love. It's a deliberate assent of God's will as a matter of principle or duty. That's this kind of love. When he says, I am with you, it's like a dad, a father. Listen, let's talk about that for a second. And I'm not talking about dads can't be sensitive and loving and pour out gift upon gift and lavish their little ones with toys and presents. I'm not talking about that. Let's just talk practically about what this father thing looks like, okay? This, I will never leave you, forsake you, I'm with you, I want to show it. How many in here have kids? Raise your hand. Okay, most of us have kids. Some of us have many, many kids. I'm trying. Okay, do you have a, and listen, I don't want some holier than thou answer here. This is honesty in church. You've got kids, right? How many of you have a sense of responsibility for every child in the world, to take care of every child in the world, the same, at the same level as your very own kids? The reason why I say that is because I don't see anyone ever in my life that goes out to do exactly that, that spends their entire life's endeavor to provide for every child. Now, there's an angst inside most Christians, I hope, to reach out and help children all over the world. I get that. But I'm talking about that same level of passion that you feel, a sense of responsibility, like these are, like you have two daughters, right? Those are yours. And I'm going to take care of them. Hell or high water, I'm going to make sure they're taken care of, right? Would you agree? And I know you. What's up, Ethan? I know you, and I think that you'd be that way. But I'm not quite sure, I'm not ripping on you, but I'm not quite sure you feel that same passion for them as you do for every single child in the world. You know what I mean? I get you. I'm talking about I don't know how many millions or billions of children there are in the world. We want to help them, but there's something about our very own, right? I mean, I know all your kids here. I love them. They're awesome little kids. I kiss them and hug them and, you know, sugar them up with cookies and send them home with you and all. That's good. But okay, I'm just being honest. I think I could be honest. Like, Jameson's different. I don't think anyone's going to shun me. Yeah, she's different. No one's going to shun me for that. She's my daughter. Do you understand what I'm saying? Now, the reason why I'm saying that, and this is not an easy one for everyone to swallow, but we're not all God's children. We're not all God's children. Not everyone on earth is God's child. Okay? Now, John 1:12 says that those that have, as many as received him, they have been given the right to be called a son or a daughter of God. Now, Genesis 1:26 says that, you know, on sixth day, God said, well, let's make man in our image to be like us. Now, I get that, but that doesn't mean you're his kid, okay? Let me see here. I always pick on you, so I'll pick on you. You're here. We both have a shirt on. That's amazing. Do you guys eat cereal ever? I do. Do you wear shoes? That's amazing. How many arms do you have? I have two arms as well. Maybe I'm your kid. Well, but we're like each other. You said that we both eat cereal, we both wear shirts, we both wear sneakers, and we both have two arms. So why? Oh, so in other words, I'm like you, but I'm not your kid. Now, would you, if I was in need, would you help me? Just say yes, even if you wouldn't. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. But would you help me to the extent you'd help that dude right there? No chance. All right, how about your angel right here? No chance. You'd kill for her, right? Yeah, you wouldn't kill for me. Maybe. If I needed you, I'd call you. You are huge, man. If Joey's out of town, I'm calling you. Give me your number. So you see what I'm saying? See, all we're creations to be like him, but that doesn't mean we're all his. We're not all his children. Romans 8:29 and 30 will tell us basically this, that those that receive the call to right standing with God in Christ, our brothers and sisters of Jesus. But if you haven't, what's that mean? You're not. You're not. As a matter of fact, in Luke 8, 19 through 21, just summarizing this, it just says, and you can read the story, it's a neat story, but he says, listen, you know who my family is? Only, use the word only. Only those that obey God's word. Only those who hear this and are doing it. Only the ones that are doing this. Like, it doesn't say perfectly, but like, are you pursuing this? Are you trying this? Are you opening it, reading it, doing it to the best of your ability and hoping for better? Yeah, so those are the people that are his family. That's what he said. Only those people that are doing that. I am the Father, and you are my son and my daughter, and I'll take care of him with you. I will show you my agapeo love. Now, here's the question I pose, and I want you to think about it. Where does this agapeo fatherly responsibility, the deliberate assent of God's will to show you his love, like where does that all start? Like how do I get that? Because that sounds good. Like I'd want that, right? I'd like for you to take care of me, but I'd rather have God take care of me. He's just way, way more awesomer than you. You may owe the cattle on one hill, but he owes on all the rest of them. So I'm gonna go with him. Okay. So how do I get that? How do I engage that God so that I can have that? You know, where do I get that? You ever ask that? Where do I get that? Well, let's find out. Let's do me a favor. John chapter 14. Go ahead and go to John chapter 14, verse 21. Let me read something to you. Just holler when you're there. Anyone? Okay. So 14:21 says this. This is Jesus talking, so you should probably pay attention. Those who accept my commandments and obey them are the ones who love me. And because they love me, my Father will love them. And I will love them and reveal myself to each of them. So did you see it there? Did you see it there? How do I get this thing? How do I get this God of the universe to be my daddy, to take care of me when my needs, like a dad does, a deliberate ascent of his will, like, I want to do this for you. How do we do it? Right, right there. How do we do it? We obey him. Right now, it seems a little bit responsive, though, doesn't it? Does reading that verse make any of you feel a little bit uncomfortable, like I have to earn it? Oh, so I have to earn it, God? Kind of sounds like that a little bit, doesn't it? A little bit responsive? Like I had to make the first move. Oh, and then you'll love me? Remember, we always talk about that our faith is not of good works, right? So it's a little bit, to me, I'm reading it, I'm like, man, that's a little bit responsive. Okay, now, who likes tension? Anyone like tension? Who takes medication for more tension? No one. Ever, right? Nobody likes tension. Well, listen to this, though. John 14, 21 says, if you love me, then my Father will love you. Almost responsive, but 1 John 4:10 says, here's real love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. 4:19 goes on to say, we love him because he first loved us. So wait a minute, I'm a little bit tense. Is anyone else tense there? Because at first it said, if you love Jesus, then my Father will love you. But then this verse here says, no, God loved you first, and so now we love him. You seeing this? And see, when I was spending time in the Word there this week, I was reading, I'm like, man, that's kind of, it's a little tense. when the angel came to Mary and said, hey, you're gonna have a baby, and you're not going to, but the Holy Spirit's going to impregnate you. You're going to have God's son. Like if an angel showed up at your place and told you that, you know, like freak out, right? So what happened? So it's, the scriptures tell us that Mary just kind of pondered these things. She pondered these things because she's probably like, What do you mean, God? Like, what? Like, because that never happened before, right? So that could be a little confusing. If it happened now, which it won't, but if it happened now, you'd be like, oh, the Mary thing? Oh, I got it. Okay, but it never happened back then. So she was probably freaking out, but it says that she pondered those things. And so that's what I did. I spent some time just thinking about that. It's like, wait a minute, how can it be this way if it's this way? And what I came to realize is that this relationship between a person and God is unlike relationships between people. What I see in these verses that God speaks through his word is a beautiful relationship where there's two parties absolutely working in unison together. Like, I'm like, I willfully obey your commandments. I want to do this for you, Lord. I want to do this for you. And the Father's doing the same thing, going, I want to do this for you because you love me and I loved you first and you love me. And I'm like, I want to do this because I love you first and you love me. And it's like going after each other. And in this world, it's like, if you say I love you first in a relationship, you're the loser, right? Remember when you were dating in high school? Don't tell her you love her. Remember? Some of the girls are giggling at us guys. And it's totally not that way with God. With God and his son, or God and his daughter, it's we're vying to see who can say I love you first. To outdo each other in honor. Like, I wanna love you. I loved you first. No, I loved you first. They're just working together like a unicycle. There's no friction in that. They're vying to say, I love you first. That's what I see there. For those who choose to serve God, God always shows up by showing his unfailing love and blessing and favor. And it didn't make any difference whether it was in the prison or in the palace. It didn't make any difference what the situation. You know what I'm saying? It didn't matter. We got some seats for you guys. Come here. Come here. Here's two right here. Here's two right here. Someone slide over. Make room for our brothers in Christ. Come on. Make room. Make room. Make room. Make room. Come on now. How you doing, man? I'm Moses. What's your name? Robert. Good to meet you, man. Good to see you, Ethan. You doing all right? Good. Good. Good to see you. Now, I want to ask you guys a question. I'm a mountain guy. I like mountains. I don't like going to the beach. To me, it's a big waste of real estate. Terrible. Boring. Standing at the beach. I'm not talking about being out on the boat. Because you're on the boat, you're fishing. I'm talking about standing on the beach. Some of you guys pay big money to go to a room and stare at a line. I don't understand that. You know what lines I like? The ones that go like this and all over. Like, the beach, if I never went to the beach again for the rest of my life, it'd be too soon. Yeah. I love the mountains. We're all different, right? Come on. Don't hate. I love the mountains. Does anyone else love the mountains? Yeah. Yeah. I love the mountains. You go vacation, you go to the mountains, right? How many people love the ocean, honestly? Love the ocean. So it's about a 50-50. That's cool. It's a non-denominational church. We can all love whatever we want. So let me ask you this. How many people are sunrise people? They love getting up and looking at the sunrise. Isn't it beautiful when it just peeks up over the, right? How many people? Raise your hand. How many people? How many people are sunset people? Oh, man. These sunrise people are crazy. Crazy. So some of us like the mountains, some of us like the ocean, some of us like sunset, some of us like sunrise. How many people love horrendous tornadoes and hurricanes and mudslides and lightning that destroy? How many people like tidal waves that crush cities? Why aren't your hands up?
Because people get killed.
You know, it's amazing. Do you know that if you read the scriptures in Job chapter 38, that book tells us that God is in control of the mountains, of the valleys, of the beach, of the waves, of the hurricane, of every raindrop that falls. He decides where every single lightning bolt will hit. He decides every single tornado, every storm that's ever hit this planet and ever will. It is absolutely God's decision. But how many people are going, oh, man, look at that tornado. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Could someone give me an amen for that tornado? No one's saying that. You know why? Because most often, and I haven't graduated, I'm just getting there, I'm taking you along with me for the ride, we don't have a proper perspective of who God is. We don't have a full view of this God that we say we know and love and serve. I don't want to serve a fake God that I made up in my own mind. And that's what we do. That's what we do. A correct doctrine will lead us to correct affection. All the time. No, I don't want to like worship some fake God that I made up in my own mind. Because that God is absolutely going to fail me. And I will question whether that God exists, hears me, is powerful anymore. Because he's not the real God. And I want us to understand who the real God is. We are made in his image. We are made in his image. He cannot be made in ours. You know, Acts 7:48 says that the Most High is not a God that lives in temples made by human hands. And this is not scripture, this is just me, but I would offer you this, that same God is not a God who's made by human minds. Okay? And we need to get rid of that. We need to know the God of the Bible in its fullness. You read from cover to cover, every word is his, and it describes him perfectly so you can worship that God. If he's some fluffy, happy-go-lucky, grace God, you're worshiping the wrong God. God is filled with love, but he's filled with wrath and anger too. That's the God of the Bible. And listen, you might not want to worship that God, but that's the God that exists. And he is, no one here is seeking him. You know that? No one. I'm not. The Bible says no one's seeking him, but you know what it says? And I think it's John 14. It says that he is seeking worshipers. He is seeking you. If you've been graced with his salvation, it's because he sought you out and opened up the eyes of your heart. That's the God who is the God of the Bible. That's the one who's worthy to be praised. He's the creator, and we're not. And we need to have a new perspective. We need to have a new perspective. So, I want to love the real God, not some God that's created. Now, the reason why I said that is if you go back to the text in Genesis chapter 45, he's coming to the end of the story here. And in Genesis 45, after all that in light of all that Joseph's gone through, you read this and it's like, wow, that's a new perspective, man. I just didn't even think that way. Because I love the God of the mountain, but I'm not quite sure I love the God of the valley. I love the God of the sunset, but I don't like the God of the tornado or the mudslide. I love the God of the beach. But I don't love the God of the famine. I just don't love that God. But Joseph gives us some clarity here about who this God is. Peaks, valleys, in the light of all the pain and suffering that Joseph went through, this is what he says. He looks at his brothers and they're caught up by surprise. He says, I'm Joseph. Remember me that you try to kill? Now, if you were writing that story, what would probably come next? Your hiney's mine, right? Boom! Remember me? Boom! But no. I'm Joseph, your brother. You think they were scared at that moment? Yeah. He could have had them killed right then and there, right? So I'd have been like, whoa, Joseph. Remember, I'm your brother Joseph, the one you sold into slavery? But don't be upset. And don't be angry with yourselves. Man, it sounds like Jesus, doesn't it? Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Almost sounds like sometimes God's got the deck stacked. I'm not going there, but I'm just saying. But don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. Jump down to verse 7. God has sent me ahead of you to keep you and your families alive and to preserve many survivors. So it was God who sent me here, not you. See, you think you sold me into slavery. You ain't done nothing. God said I'm doing this. God's the one who said, I put him in the palace, and where else? I put him in the prison. I put him in the jail, and I escalated him to the top in charge. And I also stuck him in that cistern. It was me. He's like, no, it wasn't you. You guys didn't do anything. God did this. He brought me here. So it was God who sent me here, not you. And he is the one who made me an advisor to the Pharaoh. So now you can understand, he is the second most powerful person on earth. Right? When people get out of jail, we won't even give him a job. This guy, he's not an Egyptian, and he's a criminal who was supposedly going to rape his assistant's wife, and he is now the second most powerful person in the world. Guess why? Because God was with him. That's why. That's why. You can clap for God. That's good. Do you think that there were days when Joseph, like, how many people honestly had a bad day today? You can raise your hand. Had a bad day today. A couple of you. How many people have had a bad day in the last week? Okay, pretty much everyone, okay? Do you think that there were days when Joseph's going, really? I mean, seriously? I mean, you got me, okay, you got me out of the cistern, and now you're going to make me a slave? And then you promoted me, so things are going good. Like, woo, I'm in charge of the Potiphar's house, like, opulent, everything's great. And then his wife accuses me of rape, and I'm thrown in jail even though I didn't even do anything. Really? Do you think he ever thought that? I think that. I'm a Christian. I'm a preacher. I tithe. I answer your phone call and go do all my things that I do. So why isn't everything just awesome? Am I the only one? If we're going to know this God for real, we got to get rid of this false notion that God only, that's a big word, only allows bad stuff into your life. And we got to buy into some truth. Who's in for truth in church? I'm totally about truth. We have to buy into the truth that sometimes God is the one who puts the bad, what you think is bad, you put it in the bad column, but he's the one who puts that stuff in your life. He doesn't just allow the devil to do it. Like, sometimes I get it, Job, I got it, I read the book. But sometimes it's actually God who puts you in something that you would say is bad. The correct view of God leads to the correct worship of God. That's not cool, God. You should have done it this way. You should have done it that way. No! I'll do it my way. Scriptures tell us in Isaiah 55:8 that God's ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts, and as high as the heavens are above the earth. How far is that? How far? Someone say way far. Way far. Like, as far, like, whoa, way up. As far as the heavens are above the earth, because that's where we're hanging out. That's where our thoughts are down here. So are his thoughts and his ways above ours. So we all think, well, why would I be in jail? Because God was doing something huge through this guy. He was going to use this guy to write history. He was going to use this guy to listen to, you got to understand, he was going to use this guy to save the known world. Do you understand? Do you understand the ramifications of his little time in prison that says that, and there's where he stayed. So it implies he was there for a long time. But because he was there, he was using Joseph to save the known world. So sometimes God puts you into this stuff because he's going to use your valley to change the world. See, and we don't understand that. Oh God, why would you? Listen, son, I want to change the world through you. See, it's hard to believe in our little world with our little mortgage and our little car and our little church that God would use one of us to change the world. But he's gonna. I don't even want to say he can. He's going to. Every single step you take is part of that puzzle. He is changing the world through you if you allow him to recognize putting you into this thing. Don't call it bad anymore. There's something in every valley that God's doing. Could he be, if you're in a valley today, could he be doing something like that in your valley? And stop rebuking everything that God's bringing into your life. Stop trying to pray it away. Oh, this is rough. This is not good. If it's God's will, it's going to be easy. Have you even read the Bible? If it's God's will, it's going to go smooth. Really? Ask all the guys who got their heads chopped off and impaled on poles for how smooth God's plan's going to be. I've been preaching for 12 years. I'm yet to have an easy day. It's not easy, right? It's not easy. Phone call after phone call of this person getting arrested and drugs and beaten up and jail. Man, it sucks half the time. But this is what God wants. He wants us to make disciples of the world. And that's what we have to do. It doesn't matter if it's painful. It's going to be painful. It's going to be painful. God was doing something huge in Joseph's life, and it trumped Joseph's comfort. Maybe that's why James chapter 1 verse 2 tells us that when troubles come your way, consider it. Listen, it's just consider. Just consider it an opportunity for great joy. Just stop and think about it. Maybe. You know, this kind of sucks, but maybe? Is it maybe that God's bringing me here? Or is it just bad luck? Bad karma? Throw that right out the window. Maybe God's doing something in your life. It says to consider it an opportunity for great joy, because when your faith is tested, your endurance can grow. And then I love this with an exclamation point, I'm about to yell. So let it grow! I love the gritty truth of God's word, where it's just like, you stubborn kids, let it grow! I'm trying to help you. So you got a bad circumstance, oh, God doesn't love me anymore, this Christian thing's not working out. He's like, stick with it. Give it a chance to grow. Stay in it. Stay under the pressure. No diamond is ever beautiful until the coal is what? Crushed. Pressed down. And then it's beautiful. And sometimes he needs you to stay under it for a while and quit trying to rebuke everything that God's bringing into your life. You can't, listen, I don't know every teacher in the world, but the people that tell you to just pray away everything, every sickness, every disease, every heartache, why? Do you think that Joseph was praying? Like, Lord, seriously? How about when Paul, the greatest preacher, evangelist ever, he gets shipped, he's in jail, he's whipped, he's beaten, he's shipwrecked, he finally comes to shore and a poisonous snake bites him. Like, really? Because he had massive purpose in his life. And he never stopped. He was relentless. Woe to me if I do not preach. Never forget also that if you're God's kid, that he disciplines his children. Listen, God's word says he disciplines those he loves. If you're not getting spanked on occasion, maybe you're not his. The Christian life is not always a smooth road. It's bumpy. It hurts. You give and it hurts. You serve and it's painful. Listen, this stuff in the Bible is not here to be a good story. Joseph was this and that and up and down and accused of, falsely accused of rape and put in jail. Paul was whipped and beaten, shipwrecked, starved, put in prison. Jesus Christ himself was killed. Christian life's not always easy. But that's the God we serve. Proper understanding will lead to proper worship of God. Maybe he sent you into a season of a valley to discipline you. Maybe that's what you're in now. Maybe there's something in your life that's not right. And maybe he's going to keep you in that jail cell until you start lifting your hands and lifting your voice in hymns and praise. in that jail cell. And then he'll open the door, shake the earth, and knock the shackles off your feet. God's discipline is often painful, sometimes elongated, but always beneficial. Joseph's valleys, I jotted this down, Joseph's valleys were part of God's plans to reach many, many people. And Paul's valleys were the same. Like I just mentioned, he was put in jail. Listen, if you weren't here that week, he was put in jail. Why was he put in jail? Did he do anything wrong? No. Sharing good news. He was beaten with a wooden stick and thrown in jail. Why? We know why, because when he praised and God shook the earth and the doors opened, he stayed. Why did he stay? To share the gospel with the jailer so he could be saved. And then they went to the jailer's house and he shared the gospel with them so they could all be saved. Why was he thrown in jail? Next, you ever read the book of Philemon in the Bible? It's a small book. I love it. He's thrown in jail. Why? So that this runaway slave, the person that no one in our culture likes, he was a thief and a slave, and he was thrown in jail next to the Apostle Paul. Why? That dude was getting saved. And then he was going to send him back to his slave owner and make an impact on that community as well. That's why. That's why maybe you get thrown in jail. That's why maybe a bad circumstance, something that you'd put in the bad column, God's going, no, dude, it's awesome. Stay in this thing and consider it a joy. Consider it a joy. Jesus' valley was actually on a hill, right? A hill, Calvary. He says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Father, is there any other way? Right? Remember? Is there any other way? Like, I'm in a valley, Dad. I'm not going to put the words into Jesus' mouth, but in today's vernacular, wouldn't we all just be going, dude, this absolutely sucks. Why is this happening? So Jesus is like, is there any other way? I'm in the valley. His father's like, no. That's what you got to do. Did he try to rebuke it? Pray it away? What did he do? Put that cross on his back? Yes, Dad. And the Bible tells us that because of one man's obedience, many, raise your hand if you're one of his, many will be called righteous. Because he was in the valley and he didn't try to rebuke or pray it away, he was obedient to his father. All of us have eternity forever. That's insane, dude. That's insane. That's insane. Maybe God has you in a valley for that, for a greater purpose than you think. I want to share an old verse with you, and then we'll be done. It's an old verse that if you've read the Bible at all, you've read it probably a dozen times, if not more. Could you put that up on the screen, Katie? It's that one that has all the, yeah. It's 1 Corinthians 2:9. It's that verse right there. When you read that verse, I don't know about you, but when I read it, when I've read it over and over and over again in my life, I've thought about eternity. You know, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for him, for those who love him. And so, remember I said earlier, if you choose to love him, then to love Jesus, the Father will love you, and he'll be that Father to you, and he'll just ascend, he will come to you, and he'll help you, like you're his kid. I'll love you, I'll pour it out on you. So I was thinking about eternity with this too, you know? But God's word is alive. God's word doesn't change, but it meets us in every situation, and it met me this week too. See, when you love God, everyone thinks that when you love God and you say yes to Jesus, now it's just going to be. But in this life, you will have trouble. And what I want to offer you here is that just because you love him, you have no idea what he has prepared for you. You have no idea what he has prepared for you. See, Joseph didn't have any idea that that's what God had prepared for him, that he was going to be the one who would have to suffer in jail, falsely accused, sold as a slave.
Right? He didn't know the exact circumstances that were going to come into his life, did he? And Paul didn't know. He just knew that his life was going to pour out for the gospel. He didn't know the exact things that were going to happen, but God had something prepared for him to do something awesome. And the reason why we sit in Eustis, Florida right now as saved souls for eternity is because God prepared something for Paul. And he said, woe to me if I do not do this. I got bit by a snake. I'm done. Like, I can't believe I never catch a break. But he pressed on because he knew his purpose. And because of that, he spread the gospel to other places beyond Israel. And then it spread to more people and more people and more people all the way right here, right now. And so if you're in a valley, maybe God has prepared that valley for you. It's just a perspective change, right? Listen, the seat's going this way. It's a different perspective. Look at right here. Don't look there. Look here. Your eyes need to be on Jesus. Maybe he's prepared something for you. That valley you're in right now that seems tough and you wouldn't choose it for yourself, he chose it for you possibly. Stay in it. Learn from it. Maybe he's going to use you to change the world. Right? Maybe you're that lump of coal that he's pressing on and pressing on and pressing on to make you the diamond that he wants. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart can imagine, no mind could fathom what God has planned, has prepared for you. Maybe your valley right now is what God prepared for you. Amen? I'm going to pray with you, and then we're going to give you an opportunity to worship him. Could I get you to stand? We're going to sing the song, The Stand, right?
Yes.
So let's stand. There's going to be a part of the song where it says, I stand with arms wide and heart abandoned. Now, you don't have to raise your hands if you don't want to. You do whatever you want. But it's an opportunity to just say, you know what, God? It's like a funnel, right? Whatever you've prepared, man, bring it on. Bring it on. Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for truth. I thank you that we don't have to walk around in life with our head in the clouds, wondering how we should live, wondering who you are. Because you have made it quite clear in your word who you are. You've made it quite clear that we are not seeking you, but that you are seeking us. And if you have found us, Lord, we have so much to be thankful for right now. Even if we're on the mountain and we can see clearly and we're on top of things, but sometimes, Lord, even when we're in the valley, when those mountains that you use to pick us up over everything else, sometimes those mountains loom large over us and it feels like we can't escape. But Lord, your word promises that you are with us and that you will show your unfailing love to us, whether on the mountain or in the valley. And so for that, we are thankful. Saints of God, I just encourage you as we sing to evaluate your valley. Could it be that God prepared this valley for you? Stay in it. Stay under his pressure. Seek his will in all things. Find him there. He's with you. Amen.